السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم. الحمد لله. My dear respected elders and brothers, علماء كرام حفاظ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his infinite mercy and wisdom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in spite of showering us with numerous blessings and ni'am and ni'mats, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of being able to witness this blessed day of Yawmul Jum'ah. It's only with the blessing and the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that our legs had the power to walk to the masjid. It's only with the blessing and the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that our eyes had the power to open up this morning. How many people we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he wanted to, can immediately make them paralyzed. Then their legs does not have the energy to bring them towards the masjid. How many people we find that when they go at night to sleep, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their eyes do not open the next morning. So this is only with the bounty and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Over and above that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of iman. In spite of all the other ni'mats that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us, some ni'mats that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted us, we share it with the kuffar. Example, the ni'mat of the air, of breathing oxygen, the ni'mat of the world, the ni'mat of the animals, the ni'mat of a healthy body. These are ni'mats and bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we share with the kuffar. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has hand selected us and has chosen us to give us this ni'mat and this bounty of iman. How many people in the world we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not granted them this ni'mat. This is such a ni'mat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us that does not only give us benefit in this dunya, but rather this ni'mat give us everlasting benefit in the akhirat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can we just imagine how many people are born without iman? For a person who's born without iman, for them to bring it into their hearts, to change the deen of their forefathers, to leave whatever religion they were following and to come onto the beautiful religion of Islam, how difficult would that be? If we just ponder ourselves and think that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had not granted us this ni'mat of iman from the time of birth, how difficult it would be for us to get this ni'mat of iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his infinite mercy and wisdom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us this ni'mat of iman. It comes in many riwayat that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person who just recites the kalima, la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, or the shahadat, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, these words are lifted to the heavens and a special door is open and it is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes in other riwayat that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a person who recites this kalima 100 times, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him rewards that he will not delight, that has not seen before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us this ni'mat of iman. Thereafter, not stopping at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also hand selected us, has chosen us to be part of the ummah of Nabi Kareem Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the day of Qiyamah, it will be this Nabi that will intercede on behalf of all the ummahs. It will be this Nabi that will intercede in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where no other Nabi would dare to go. This Nabi of ours, where on the Hawdha Kawthar will give us water from his hands to drink. So these are great, great ni'mas that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, in a famous poem of his, he says, تعصي الإله وتظهر حبه هذا محال وفي القياس بديع لو كان حبك صادقا لأطعته إن المحب لمن يحب مطيع. He says, regarding the ni'mas of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that in spite of the ni'mas of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تعصي الإله وتظهر حبه, that you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but outwardly you show the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هذا محال وفي القياس بديع. He said, this is something that's impossible. Logic cannot understand it. When someone loves something, then the inward and the outward shows complete subservience to that person. But he's saying the Muslim community and the Muslim ummah is such that ta'asi lilaha, that they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but outwardly that they show the Muslims, outwardly we show that we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هَذَا مَحَالٌ وَفِي الْقِيَاسِ بَدِيعٌ. Thereafter he says, what's the result, what's the solution to this? لَوْ كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتَهُ. If your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was صادق, was truthful, لَأَطَعْتَهُ, then you would have obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. That a person who loves his beloved is subservient to his beloved. So what is the manner and the mannerism and the ways of making shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explained to us by Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, that he says if a person loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if a person wants to show his gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what should he do? He should obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us these ni'mat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of iman, of being part of the ummah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Over and above that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of a healthy body, of wealth, of family, of wives, of spouses, of children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of the animals around us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the ni'mat of the sky, the sun and the moon. In many ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this world and whatever's in it is created for insan, is created for the human population. So these are ni'mat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a riwayat, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that everything in this world is created for you, وَأَنْتُمْ خُلِقْتُمْ لِلْآخِرَةِ, and you are created for akhirat. So what does this show? That to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to utilize these items that was created for our khidmat, that was created for the benefit of insan, to utilize it in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That our eyes do not see except what Allah and His Rasul command us to see. Our hands do not touch anything except what Allah and His Rasul command us to touch. Our legs do not go into the direction except what Allah and His Rasul command us to go towards that direction. Our heart does not think and perceive anything except what Allah and His Rasul commands us to think of. These are the ways and the mannerism of making shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslim ummah and the Muslim population is divided where some of the, actually you can say 100% of the Muslim people, we are sinners. Each and every one of us are sinners. But it's our natural disposition, our fitrat, having iman in our heart, that we strive towards pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That no matter what type of a Muslim person you are, no matter how much guna you make, how much sins you commit, but it's a natural disposition, because this iman is such a pure thing in our heart. This iman is such a thing that if it's put on the scales on the day of Qiyamah on one scale, and on the other scales there's 99 scrolls that can spread out to the horizon, and that is of sins put on the other scale, this iman will outweigh our sins. So because of this iman, it in its purity, it gives us the thinking and it gives us the himmat to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do some good actions. No matter what type of a person it is, no matter how big of a sinner it is. For example, we all know the story of the woman that committed zina, of the woman that was a zaniya, she was a prostitute, and she goes towards the well where she sees a dog dying out of thirst, and she takes water and she gives it to the dog, and through that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants her jannah. This is because of the small iota of iman in the heart, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the natural instinct to do good. When it comes to doing good, generally, people look for things that they can do which will reap them great reward but easy to do. As human beings, we don't want to do stuff that are difficult and the reward is small. But rather, we want to get the ultimate amount of reward with the least amount of work. And this is not only, this is our nature. As human beings, is our nature. We don't want to go through a lot of difficulty for a small benefit. But rather, we want to reap great benefits with a small amount of mujahada and sacrifice. So Imam Ghazali rahimahullah beautifully mentions that one amal to do, or one action that we can do which is small, which is easy, but will grant us great rewards, is the amal of dhikr. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah mentions, after the tilawat of Quran, how important is the tilawat of Quran? After the tilawat of the Quran, the greatest action that the tongue can do is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, كلمتان حبيبتان إلى الرحمن, ثقيلتان على اللسان، ثقيلتان في الميزان، خفيفتان على اللسان، سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم. That Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, there are two such kalima, meaning these subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-azim, but in a broader view you can say dhikr, to make the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What he says, khafifatani ala al-lisan. That these kalimat and the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very light on the tongue. It's something that you can do whilst doing other actions. It's not that you have to take out specific time to do it. That throughout the day you can practice on this amal. So he says, خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى اللِّسَانِ. That this dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that's light on the tongue. So a person will naturally think that if it's a small action, if it's a light action on the tongue, then the reward is not so great. Thereafter, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to rebuke that claim, he says, ثَقِيلَتَانِ فِي الْمِيزَانِ. That it's, in spite of it being easy to fulfill, easy to carry out, but it's heavy on the scales on the day of Qiyamah. What is it? Subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-azim. That if a person says it once, subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-azim, what great rewards he will benefit in akhirah. Comes in another hadith that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person who just says subhanallah in the morning, a tree will be planted for him in Jannah where a horse can ride under its shade for 1,000 years. It comes in another riwayat of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that a person on the day of Qiyamah in Jannah, the only thing that the people of Jannah will be remorseful about is not having made more dhikr in the dunya. Seeing what great reward that dhikr reaps a person in the akhirat, people that are in Jannah, they are Jannatis already, they are inside Jannah, the only regret they'll have is that why didn't we make more dhikr in the dunya. In another riwayat, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من قال سبحانالله وبحمده مئة مرة. Whoever says subhanallah wa bihamdihi 100 times every day, حُتَّتْ خَطَايَاهُ وَإِنْ كَانَ مِثْلُ زَبَدِ الْبَحْرِ. That his gunas will fall off from him. His sins will be forgiven. وَإِنْ كَانَ مِثْلُ زَبَدِ الْبَحْرِ. Even though it's equivalent to the foam in the oceans. You can just imagine with one wave how much foam is created in the ocean. So it's equivalent to all the foam in all the oceans for as long as the oceans existed. If he just says subhanallah wa bihamdihi 100 times in the morning or 100 times in a day, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive that amount of sins from him. What are the other benefits? There are 6 benefits that's mentioned by Imam Ghazali rahimahullah in Ihya'i Ulum al-Din. He mentioned 6 benefits of dhikr. The first benefit, he says, that via dhikr, by you remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remember you. There's a famous story of Mahmud and Ayaz. Mahmud was a king and Ayaz was the slave of the king, or you can say he was part of the court of the king. So Mahmud called all the personnel of his court and he said, whatever is in the palace, you have so much amount of time, X amount of time, go and whatever you can carry in your hands, by the time I give you ends, whatever you got in your hands, you can take with you. So all the people of the court went around and started picking up gold, jewels, diamonds, etc. Ayaz remained next to the king. Just before that, the king could say, now your time has terminated, Ayaz put his hand on the king's head. So everyone said, now this is a ajib, he's an amazing type of person, what type of a person he is. So after the king had finished, the king asked Ayaz, why did you do this? He said, all of them had took gold and silver, which will last them only a certain amount of time. After that, they'll come back to the court. But if I put my hand on the king, meaning I got the king. If I got the king, I got whatever's left. So Imam Ghazali says, via dhikr, you remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but in a similar mannerism, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers you. In the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ وَشْكُرُولِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. If you remember me, I will remember you. Thabit Bunani, who is a famous tabi'i, he says, he told the people around him, أَعْلَمُ مَتَى يَذْكُرْنِيَ اللَّهِ. That I know the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers me. So the people around him said, what is he saying? They got amazed, they got upset with what is he saying. He said, because of this ayat, whenever I make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes dhikr of me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers me. And like we mentioned with Ayaz and Mahmud, that once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions you, what won't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you? So this is the greatest reward and benefit virtue of dhikr. That only by mentioning this virtue of dhikr is enough, is sufficient. But us as insan, we need more and more virtues to encourage us to do more. So part of this, in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. That when my banda asks me, when my slave asks me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, then I am close to him. Another ayat showing that if we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close to us. In another hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, is a hadith Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي عَبْدِي فِي نَفْسِي ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِي. That when my servant remembers me in his heart, I remember him in my heart. وَإِذَا ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّنْ. If he remembers me in a gathering, then I will remember him in a gathering better than his gathering. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make mention of us to the angels. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ شِبْرًا تَقَرَّبْتُ إِلَيْهِ ذِرَاعًا. If he comes towards me a handspan, I will go towards him arm's length. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا أَتَانِي يَمْشِي أَتَيْتُهُ هَرْوَلَةً. If he comes to me walking, I will go to him running. The muhaddithin mention, what is the meaning of this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to us running? It means that whenever we lift our hands and ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, immediately our du'as will get accepted. And du'as being accepted is not only in this dunya, but rather du'as being accepted in the akhirah. So this is one of the greatest rewards of making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second virtue of making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us tranquility. Who in this dunya, which insan does not want a peaceful heart? Does not want tranquility in his life? No matter how much worldly gains you got, no matter what big house you got or what a smart car you got, but none of this can give you tranquility. How many times you see a person, he got everything of this dunya, but he'll still commit suicide, or he'll go towards drugs, or he'll go towards murder. This is because he got everything of the dunya, but he doesn't have the being that created the dunya. We need to strive and attain the being that created the dunya. And then after we get that, we will get everything in the dunya. So one of the second virtue of making dhikr is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us tranquility in our hearts. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. That via the dhikr and the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us tranquility in our hearts. Allama Alusi, who is a mufassir, he wrote the tafsir of the Quran Kareem. In this ayat he mentions that إِنَّ سَبَبَ الطَّمَأْنِينَ نُورٌ يُفْضِيهِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى عَنْ قَلْبِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. That what is this tranquility in the heart? That when a person makes dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put nur and light in his heart. And when this nur and light comes into his heart, فَيَذْهَبُ مَا فِيهَا مِنَ الْقَلَقْ وَالْوَحْشَ وَنَحْوِ ذَلِكَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away from his heart. Once the nur enters your heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away all darkness. And what is darkness? Darkness is depression, the need for more, and things, everything that opposes tranquility, that is the darkness in the heart. So once the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters the heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove all our worries from our heart. The third virtue of making dhikr is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make us spiritually alive. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in the hadith, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. That a person who remembers Allah, the example of a person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the example of a person who does not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the example of the living and the dead. That if a person remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his heart is loving. When a person's heart is loving, it never dies. Our bodies might die in this dunya, but forever our heart will remain loving. And a person who does not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then is like a dead person. Even though he might be physically alive in his dunya, but in his heart, he is dead. And the fourth virtue of making dhikr is salvation in the akhirah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions a hadith where he mentions seven people on the day of Qiyamah, seven groups of people on the day of Qiyamah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him shade under his arsh on a day where the sun will be so close to our heads, where some people will be drowning in their sweat, where the sweat will be for some people up until their knees, some people up until their waists, some people up until their chin, and even more. So on that day, the only shade will be the arsh, the shade of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of these seven people is the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, رَجُلٌ ذَاكِرُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى خَالِيًا, a person who mentions, who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ, and his eyes begin to tear up, meaning he mentions Allah, he remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone with no one around. And he ponders over the ni'mas of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because of the gunas he did in opposing the ni'mas of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he begins to cry. And why he's crying? Min khashyatillah, only out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the type of person on the day of Qiyamah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him shade under his arsh, on a day that there will be no shade. And the fifth virtue is the virtue that everyone looks for in this dunya, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us rizq. Risk from places that we cannot even imagine. In a hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ لَزِمَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِكُلِّ ذِيكٍ مَخْرَجًا وَلِكُلِّ هَمٍ فَرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. That a person who continuously makes istighfar is istighfar on the lips, which would fall under the category of dhikr. So مَنْ لَزِمَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ, a person who continuously makes istighfar, جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِكُلِّ ذِيكٍ مَخْرَجًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take him out from every tight position. Whichever tight position he's in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take him out. مِنْ كُلِّ ذِيكٍ مَخْرَجًا وَلِكُلِّ هَمٍ فَرَجًا, and any problem he's had, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take him out of that problem. وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him rizq from avenues that he cannot even imagine. So this is one of the benefits of making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions regarding Hud alayhi salam. Hud alayhi salam, when he was preaching to his people, to Ad was a nation who were very strong. In today's time, according to some people, the Ad were the people of Petra. So they were people that could mold the mountains into the houses. So they were very strong people. And they had huge fruit gardens. So there was nothing absent from their lives. After they denied Hud alayhi salam, and they told him that we're not going to believe in you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a drought. So what Hud alayhi salam told him, what's the remedy to this drought? وَيَا قُومِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ, O my people, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ, then return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The difference between istighfar and tawbah is quite famous. Istighfar is to make istighfar for your previous sins, and tawbah is to make a wa'ada and a promise that you will not return to their sins in the future. So Hud alayhi salam told his people, وَيَا قُومِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ. What is the result of this? يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send rain from the continuous rain from the skies. So it shows that to make istighfar, to make the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will grant us rizq. That يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيَزِدْكُمْ قُوَّةً إِلَىٰ قُوَّتِكُمْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more power than what you had before. So like I said, physically the people of Ad were very strong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Mufassirin explained that this can mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them power physically, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them power, meaning tranquility in the heart. Or other Mufassirin explained that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them power. What is the power of a person, a man? His main power is the sons that he has. Because your sons carry on your lineage. When you get old, these are the people that are going to look after you. So this is the benefit of making the dhikr and istighfar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And lastly, the great benefit of dhikr, that it gives us great rewards. In the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, مَا مِنْ قَوْمٍ اِجْتَمَعُوا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَا يُرِيدُونَ إِلَّا وَجْهَ. There is no such people that gather together remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِلَّا نَادَاهُمْ مُنَادٍ فِي السَّمَاءِ, except a call comes from the heavens and tells them that قُومُوا مَغْفُورًا لَكُمْ, that stand in such a way that all your sins are forgiven. Not only that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins, but through the blessings of making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ بُدِّلَتْ لَكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ حَسَنَاتٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change your bad deeds into good deeds. Not only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change your bad deeds into good deeds. Our Ustad Hazrat Muhammad Abdullah Maulvi Saab, he mentions, when a person is making dhikr, so the method and the way of making zikr, there are two different methods of making zikr. One is to hold a tasbih in your hand and throughout the day to keep your tongue moist with the zikr. Another is to sit quietly, take out a time, 5-10 minutes of the day, to sit alone in a room, like we mentioned in the hadith, that a person, he sits alone, ففاضت عيناه, and he remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much that he begins to cry. So you sit alone, and you take out time to make the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the dhikr that's prescribed by many of the mashayikh is that in the morning and night, to read 100 times the third kalima, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyy al-azim. 100 times in the morning, 100 times in the night. And after that, to read 100 times in the morning, 100 times in the night, istighfar, astaghfirullah, alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayk. Or a person can just read, astaghfirullah. And lastly, to read 100 times in the morning, 100 times in the evening, durood sharif, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallayta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. So these are the dhikr and the adhkar is prescribed by most of the mashayikh, something that's easy to carry out. It's 300 times in the morning, 300 times in the evening. And when making dhikr, then a person should have the niyat before making dhikr. Four niyats to make before you start making dhikr. One is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must take away the atarat and the effects of kufr and nifaq from our heart and put hidayat. Even though we have iman in our heart, but the effects of the west and the kufr are in our hearts. Each and every person got these effects. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, via the dhikr, via the nur of the dhikr, must take this out of our hearts. The second, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must remove the bad qualities from our heart and instill good qualities into our heart. The third, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must take us out from doing wrong and bring us on to doing ita'at and obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the fourth is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must take us out of ghaflat and ignorance, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must put His recognition and His ma'rifat into our heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to make amal of whatever has been said. Request is made that before the khutbah starts, if everyone can come to fill the sufuf before the khutbah starts. So when the khutbah starts, the